Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, verses 13 to 27. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the road is easy that leads to destruction, and there are many who take it. For the gate is narrow, and the road is hard that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorns or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will know them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many deeds of power in your name? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you evildoers. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. But it did not fall, because it had been founded on rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell, and great was its fall. May God's blessing be upon this, the holy word.
Here's how close we are to Easter. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. Can you believe that? And thank you to those who said they'd donate palms. I think we're going to have palms for enough people for everybody to come in and wave palms next week, which is going to be fun. And I'll do that too, so be prepared next week. And that means this is our last Sunday where we're studying Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Remember, according to Matthew's Gospel, and this is where we get the Sermon on the Mount, according to Matthew's Gospel, this was Jesus' first public speaking engagement, if you want to look at it in that sort of way. This is where Jesus lays out the framework for his entire ministry. This is where he makes it clear that he is the ambassador for this kingdom of heaven. This is where he highlights the radical differences between the reign of God and the reign of the kingdoms of the earth, like Caesar. And what we're seeing here in chapter 7 today is actually the climax of this whole Sermon on the Mount. If you want to look at it in terms of modern day preaching, this is when the preacher comes along and says, and in conclusion, my final point is, and you know, of course, you want to take it in modern day preaching terms, that means the preacher just might go for another 10 or 12 minutes in our time frame, right? But I can't remember whether I told you this or not, but I visited a church this summer when I was on sabbatical that wasn't quite a mega church, but it was definitely the kind of church where, you know, here we've got stained glass and crosses and things like that. This didn't happen. It was more like a stage. There's a stage with stage lights and video equipment, even more sophisticated than ours. And in the back, there was a sound booth that was actually raised up to the level of the stage. And on this sound booth, there was a big old digital clock about this big. And I thought, okay, well, that must be what time it is, but it's not. They would have an oddball time up there, and then it would count backwards. And then it dawned on me what this was for. It was so that the people up on stage knew how much longer they had to do whatever. And so when the praise band came up, it was 10 minutes, and it was 9:59, 9:58. And so the praise band knew that you that you were able to play enough praise songs for 10 minutes. So as the clock wound down, then the band kind of wound down. And then when it hit zero, the band went away. And then they'd have a testimony time. People would come on up and testify what God has been doing in their life and all the wonderful things that were happening. And again, the clock was winding down. And as the clock got closer to zero, the people would wind down their testimony and they'd go along. They even did that for offering. Can you believe that? I've got to tell you, I was impressed at their time management skills, I guess it is. So then the preacher got up to preach, and I thought, I wonder how long they're going to give it. Because I've noticed that the average person's attention span, as far as a sermon goes, is different depending on geographical locations, okay? When I lived back in the South, when I lived in Virginia and was preaching in the Appalachians, a preacher, get this, needed to preach at least 25 minutes for the church to think they got their money's worth. I'm not kidding. These people would watch their clocks, all right? And if you preach anything less than 25 minutes on the way out of church, when you're greeting people on the way out of church, people would give you that little, I'm being polite because I'm culturally obligated, smile. And they would say, nice talk, preacher. Because, and that's their way of saying, that wasn't really a sermon. And I refuse to call it a sermon, which is why I'm calling it a talk. Do better next time. All of that in one little phrase, right? So I discovered, when I came to California, I discovered that the average attention span for a sermon in a mainline Protestant church is about 20 minutes. And let me tell you, that is the maximum time, too. 15 minutes is the preference. So I was quite surprised when this church, at this low-key megachurch, the pastor got up and the countdown clock was set to 40 minutes. 40 minutes! And do you know what that clock meant? Absolutely nothing. Because as that clock was getting to zero, he wasn't quite winding down. The clock hit zero and he hadn't even come to the... And my final point is, I thought, okay, so when that clock hits zero, is it going to start flashing red? Is it going to start, going up? Nope, because it kept on going and going. So anyway, I don't imagine that Jesus had any problems with time limits when it came to his preaching. What he had to say was so radically different than any other preacher or teacher at that time that I think he had an absolutely captive audience. But here's how Jesus winds down this sermon. He shifts gears and he starts talking in binary either-or terms. Okay? For instance, there are two gates leading to two roads. You can't travel both. The wide, smooth road, that road leads to destruction. But the narrow, rocky path, that path leads to life. Take a nice, easy, paved, smooth road like the Romans built. Choose that path and go along with the rest of the crowd who just want a smooth, easy road, and you'll end up in disaster. But if you dare to be different and choose the challenging path, you will understand what it means to live an abundant life. Because those of you who are hikers, isn't it true that sometimes that path that's hard to take leads to the best things, right?
Amen.
And then you get the two vines and the two trees. Each produce two different kinds of fruit. You choose the wrong one and you're going to get all scratched up by thorns. You choose the other and you will live a fruitful life. And then you got two groups of people. You've got one entering into Jesus' presence, and then you've got the other leaving Jesus' presence. Now, one group has all sorts of things to brag about as far as their religious credentials are concerned. But Jesus is impressed. It's just talk. It's just words. But the other group knows Jesus. They live their faith by action, not by words. And then you've got two builders, like we were talking about up here with children's moment. You got one who builds his house on the sand, and you've got one who builds his house on the rock. These are both people who've heard Jesus' message, but when the storms of life hit, the one who built their house on the rock survives. This is the one who, again, doesn't just hear Jesus' message, but is motivated to act on Jesus' message. Now notice that what Jesus is pointing out in all of these illustrations is that there's a difference between people who get his message and people who do not get his message. Now here's where we get in trouble. Here's where church people can get in trouble, because we can get messed up when we are presented with these either-or binary choices, because some people think that these things, these binary choices, all lead up to something like turn or burn. And that's not the case. And I notice that folks who think this way tend to view God as one who is angry and needs to be appeased through sacrifice. They see God as harsh and demanding, requiring humans to earn God's favor by engaging in radical rule-keeping. They think that somehow God is always in their heads, looking through the crevices of their minds and thoughts for complete religious correctness. But Jesus teaches a different way. And so before we misinterpret these either-or statements that we hear at the end of this sermon, let's review the substance of the whole Sermon on the Mount, okay? The Beatitudes, which is what starts out, launches the Sermon on the Mount. Beatitudes encourage us to have an attitude of a servant. Show mercy, work for peace, be gentle, hunger and thirst for righteousness, dare to be boldly different. And then be the salt that flavors the earth. Be the light that shines through the darkness of this world. Demonstrate your difference from the rest of the world through your works of generosity. Don't conform to tradition for tradition's sake, but don't rebelliously reject it either. Understand the intent of the tradition and appreciate it. Grow from it. Don't hold grudges or indulge in anger. Be agents instead of reconciliation. Monitor your desires. Don't pretend that they're not there, because you're not going to hide from them. But don't dwell on them. Don't fantasize about them. Be faithful in guarding your hearts. Don't make vows that you don't intend to keep. Love your enemies as your friends. Imitate God. Be big-hearted and generous. Give to the poor. Pray without ceasing, but don't do it as a public display of how religious you are. Resist temptation. Trust God. Don't let greed cloud your outlook on life. Store up wealth by being generous and kind. Don't be a slave to material resources. Don't let anxiety run and ruin your life. Instead, trust God's care. Seek God first. And don't spend all your energy pointing out the faults of other people while you are blind to your own. Don't push your faith on other people, because when you do this, then people aren't going to recognize what a treasure and a gift faith really is. Don't be afraid to go to God with your needs and your desires. But don't be discouraged if you don't get everything you ask for in the way that you ask for it. Because God will come through in due time, and perhaps in unexpected ways. Treat others as you would want to be treated. Realize that life is full of tough choices, even for those who place their faith in God. Thriving sometimes includes suffering. Don't let others' religious talk mislead you. Instead, live by Jesus' teachings. So, there it is, Sermon on the Mount in a nutshell. Notice then, when you look at the entire Sermon on the Mount as a whole, we see a vision of a gracious and compassionate God who does not need to be appeased through sacrifice. And notice that Jesus paints a clear picture of a God whose love is freely given. You don't have to earn God's love. What God wants from us, most of all, more than anything else, is to be co-ambassadors with Jesus and to proclaim that good news, that message from God's reign, that God's reign is unfolding right here on earth. And it's surprisingly similar to what the prophets of the Old Testament desired and preached for Israel, too. Except in the case of Jesus, this desire extends to everyone beyond Israel. Everyone from all nations, all walks of life, all people throughout all time and all places. Do justice. Love mercy. Walk humbly with God. Ultimately, the choice that counts more than anything else as far as Jesus is concerned is which path will you choose? The path that resembles the kingdoms of the earth or the path that leads to the reign of God? So, if you were there on that hillside in the outback of Judea in Galilee listening to Jesus, would you have said yes to Jesus' way? Well, the nice thing is that you don't have to put yourself in that time and in that place in history to answer that question. That question applies here, now, today. And that is, which way, which path, which road, which kingdom will you choose?